Hello and welcome to the episode 96 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, among other things, we have a farewell ball, a pirate radio prize, and a groundbreaking recording session. Let's open the dances with the now usual top 10 club gig. On the 6th of April 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, performed another gig for their second residency in Hamburg, West Germany. Moving on 1 year, in 1962, the Beatles, still featuring Pete Best, performed two concerts in a day. A lunchtime concert at the Cavern Club in Liverpool, and then, at night, a 2.5-hour Beatles farewell ball at the Tower Ballroom in Wallasey, sharing the bill with Emil Ford and the Checkmates. The ball was one of the last engagements before the band's third trip to Hamburg. Another performance on the 6th of April 1963 with the Beatles, now with Ringo Starr on drums, busy at the Pavilion Gardens Ballroom in Buxton. In 1964, the Fabs were at the Twickenham Film Studios to shoot the makeup room sequence for their A Hard Day's Night film. Same venue 1 year later in 1965 for the Beatles' second feature film. Today, the band completed the sequence of the interior dining area and the kitchen of the Rajahama restaurant. During a break in the filming, the lads received the Bell Award from Pirate Radio Radio Caroline, presented to them by DJ Simon D. The informal ceremony and an impromptu interview were filmed by newsreel cameras and broadcast at an unspecified date. It was also around this time that the Beatles probably recorded an interview with the other leading British pirate radio, Radio London. Also on this date, the 4-track EP Beatles For Sale, containing songs from the album with the same name, went on sale in the UK, the 8th EP in the Beatles UK discography. Before moving forward, let me remind you that your comments about what you like or dislike about the show are always welcomed. In fact, if you fancy the show, you could do worse than visiting www.simonmas.com/support to find out how you can help me putting out increasingly better music-related content completely free of charge. Please be fab and make the difference. Thank you! On the 6th of April 1966, the Beatles began recording their new album, eventually called Revolver. It was a turning point in the band's career, just like the whole 1966. Revolver showed the band at the peak of their creativity, with wild music experiments and highly incisive lyrics. The focus of the Beatles had now almost completely turned on studio work. Apart from all the other usual problems, the 1966 tour showed the Beatles at their worst musically. The four had become lazy, sloppy, unfocused, uninterested, playing short sets and often sounding out of tune and off-key. Not so in the studio. The three takes necessary to pin down the rhythm track for the first song of the new album, Mark I, was a tangible demonstration of their attention. While the song was placed at the end of the album, Tomorrow Never Knows, as it was later called, was actually the very first to be recorded. Its iconoclastic one-chord structure and its sound, created thanks to experiments with tape loops or studio innovations like ADT, automatic double tracking, set the stage for what had to come. George Martin and the new balance engineer, 20-year-old Jeff Emerick, were instrumental to the new sound just as much as the Beatles themselves, translating into technical procedures the sometimes vague instructions of the band and trying to experiment and find new sounds in the studio. The initial takes sound different from the final result that ended up on Revolver. Take 1 has been released on the Anthology 2 album if you are curious, but the song still represents a radical departure from the band's usual output and from contemporary pop music. The tracks consisted of Ringo Starr's drums, Paul McCartney's bass riff, George Harrison's tambura, and John Lennon's vocals. From the very start, John's request to sound, I quote, like the Dalai Lama singing from a mountaintop, miles away, unquote, was accommodated by Jeff Emerick by feeding his vocal track to a Leslie speaker, a revolving speaker generally used in Hammond organs. This serves as one of the examples of the sonic experimentations going on in the studio at this stage. Take 3 was chosen as the basis for further work by the band. The session started at 8 p.m. in the Studio 3 of the Abbey Road EMI Studios, was wrapped up at 1:15 a.m. Finally, in 1967, Paul McCartney and his girlfriend Jane Asher started a holiday around Denver, Colorado. Beatles assistant Mal Evans rented a car and drove them around the Rocky Mountains. They hiked a bit, canoed in a river, and walked barefoot in the snow. In the evening, Paul and Asher ate at a house they borrowed by a common friend and fell asleep watching his color TV, still a novelty in the UK. Talking about Britain today, working between 7 p.m. and 1 a.m. at the EMI studios, George Martin and his team produced mono and stereo mixes of Good Morning, Good Morning, and then a tentative master tape for the Sgt. Pepper's album. Using the Beatles' directives, there were no reels between songs, the technical name for gaps, something very unusual for a pop album. The song list at this stage was Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, with a little help from my friends, being for the benefit of Mr. Kite, Fixing a Hole, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, Getting Better, She's Leaving Home on side 1, and Within You Without You, When I'm 64, Lovely Rita, Good Morning, Good Morning, Sgt. Pepper's Reprise, and A Day in the Life on side 2. This concludes today's episode. Tomorrow, we'll have a whole lot of different studio sessions spread throughout the years. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.